You can remain seated for now, and I invite Carl Sundquist to share a few words with us.
Hello. Welcome. My name is Chris Swift. I'm the youngest of five children here today. Our family would like to thank those who came to the visitation yesterday and are here today for your support. For those that have traveled out of town, thank you as well for coming. My father's family, the Swift family, came from Northwest Ireland in 1845, Sligo County. My grandfather, Frederick Swift, was born in Coal Branch, and Mary McCachran, my dad's mom, born in Bass River Point. Large families. My grandfather had 13 in his family, and my dad's mother had 12 in her family. Dad was born in Moncton, January 8, 1926. His only siblings was Eileen, who was born 3 years after. Eileen's family is here today. Eileen passed away in May of this year. I'm very sorry for her loss to you guys. Most of the Swift family was involved in the railroad. My grandfather was a telegraph operator for 37 years. And, sorry, I guess I'm turning away from the mic. I asked my dad how special is God to him. He told me, "I believe in God in heaven, and I will see my past family there." Dad liked to laugh. Christmas was a favorite time in our household, and it will be this year. We will remember him as he would like us to. Dad loved a lot of animals. His dog, Mike. His first St. Bernard, he had horses, he had cows, chickens, everything up on the farm. Saturday dances were important to my father. He was one of the few that had a car, so he liked to drive his friends. His first car drive when he was driving was 9 years old. Yes, my father was driving at 9 years old. He had to stand up to drive, and he passed a Mountie. So Dad said he almost drove in the ditch that day. So married life, my father, he met my mother, Teresa, at a dance. Surprising. He was hooked as soon as he saw her that day. And they were married on June 1st, which I believe was my grandfather's birthday, 1949, in South Branch Catholic Church. They stayed at their in-laws. He worked in Harcourt and Canaan, and then they moved to Moncton. They bought their first house in 1962. Five kids, as I think I mentioned at the start. Moved between Moncton and Riverview. Mom and Dad had a good marriage. Married for 53 years. It was tough to bring up five kids, but they did the best they could. My mother passed away in 2003. Recently, my fiance and I were here to see my father in October, and we went over to Riverview and we were driving around, and I said, "I want to show you where a lot of my good memories are with my family and where we lived on 118 Montgomery Avenue." And I showed her the house. It was a very small house. So I don't know how we all, as a family of five and grandchildren and spouses, fit in that house at Christmas time, but we did it. My parents, my dad moved to People's Park. He had a friend named Nettie O'Brien after my mom passed a few years after. They met when Dad was 15, upcountry, as we like to call it. They got to reconnect at People's Park, and it was a special time for Dad and Nettie to get together. They knew each other back when they were young kids. So it was special, and I'm glad my father wasn't alone in his later years. Dad was a handyman. He built his first house. He was an electrician. He did stuff around the house that, you know, most men of that era did. He passed that on to my sister Carol Ann and my brother that are here today, and not me at all. the one thing I want to mention is I came home one weekend when I was at university, and Dad said, "Can we build a shed together?" I said, "Sure, we can build a shed together." So we started hammering away, and he was measuring and cutting, and then he just come over, and he just touched me on the shoulder and said, boy, stay in school, get an education. kitchen, very important for my father. He was a very good cook. He liked to make apple pies, seafood casserole. Mm. His apple pie was the best, so just so you know, competitions. What else? He could eat a lobster, body, everything. Whatever was left, we just gave it to my father. He really liked the lobster. Favorite time, as I might have alluded to, is Christmas. We had a really good time, lots of games. I remember Family Feud, playing those games when it became popular at People's Park. At Point Park. We played Family Feud, so that was big back in the 80s. Lots of people dropping by. I won't bring up this. I guess when my sister called to tell me my dad had passed, I had a favorite Christmas song, and it was playing that day when she called me. So I'll always remember my dad. Sorry. When that song plays. Favorite pastime? Playing cards. So that era, I keep mentioning that era because my dad, he had a lot of relatives that came by the house. He went up country a lot. So they played crib, they played rummy. Skip Bo was his game recently. I don't know if that's a really old game, but he played a lot for the last 25 years. And Lynn, my fiance, and I were here a year ago, and we got him a game so we could play Skip Bo. And he won. He won that game. He was 96, and he won that game. So I think he was cheating. He didn't cheat. He was a very serious card player, though. Favorite place? Dad always had a soft spot for Bass River. Brought back many memories. Parley Beach was another one of his. We had a trailer out there for 20 years. And the first trailer we had in 1970 was a little 19-foot, again, to the small house, to a small trailer. There's a similarity there. We squeezed in that. Lots of card nights at Ocean Surf. Lots of really good friends. Mom and Dad were the happiest there, I think, at Parley Beach. The other hot spot, and I have to mention this, the other hot spot for my father was Tim Hortons. I know that there are some of his friends here today, and they also came yesterday, and I gave them a hug. He really liked that place. I want to thank you. You gave, as I said here, you were close friends of my dad's. He went every week, and then at the end of it, he went once a week on Thursday. So I mentioned to one of his friends from Tim Hortons, I said, we can't do it at Tim Hortons today. I'm sorry. You've got to come here. But you gave him purpose. And he really enjoyed Tim Hortons, and I thank you for being there for him and the stories that you would share. Dad's career, I'll just mention that he was traveling. He worked as a dispatcher till he left school in grade 10 because Gramps was sick. He was an operator. He worked at that for 17 years, and then he also moved on to selling Rusco windows. And then he started his own company that he had for 50 years called Swift Sales Agencies. So it was easy for him to get a job there. Dad could work in any... he traveled everywhere in the Maritimes. He traveled every community. He was dedicated and committed. Monday he left. Friday he came back. He traveled lots. Many of us talk about places in the world that we've gone to and things we've seen. Dad did not travel the world. He traveled around the Maritimes for many years as work. He would tell me about the people he met and their stories. I guess the question is, which one is better? Dad drove until he was over 80 years old. He was still driving and delivering his hoops to Halifax. He liked it. He liked to just be active. and to make some cash. Dab is a good hockey player, as he told me many a times. We used to go to Louis Levesque on Sundays to play. And Dad, the sons could come out at intermission and play. It was just a really special time to be with my dad because he was only home on weekends. Mom and Dad had a membership at Magnetic Hill Golf Course. They played a lot of rounds. And a lot of times from my nephews, they would say that when they played with Dad out west, they had to bring two scorecards. One that Dad told him he shot, and one that Dad did shoot. So one of the two. I will mention this one thing, and you know, hockey, the stories, the golfing with my dad. We had so much fun. One story that my father, we were out playing in Calgary, and I kept hitting in the woods just all day. I had a terrible game. So he said, "Son, I know what the problem is." And I said, "What?" He says, "You're missing a club in your bag." And I said, "What?" Says, "Well, you're in the tree, so you should have brought an axe." Dad was a prominent member of the UCT, Council 748, life member of the Knights of Columbus. He was involved in the Irish community chapter in Moncton. He was involved with the Catholic Church in Riverview here and at People's Park. I brought my dad here, and we sat up there behind the Father Phil. We sat there. It was in April. And I said to him, "You know, Dad, this is the last time I was in this church was Mom's funeral 20 years ago." So, has a special spot. Dad had many, many grandchildren, great-grandchildren. He loved them all, and they loved him. He is going to be missed a lot by all of us. I may have missed a few spots. I'm trying to move along here. So if anybody wants a copy, they can have a copy later. So I asked my dad what his best strengths were. He said, "Be good to people, talk to them, be a good listener." I think he was definitely more than just that. He had a big heart. He was a great father, loved his wife and family, cherished his friends, would give his time for anything you needed for him, always had a smile, a wink every time you met him. He loved to hear or tell a good story. He was a hard worker, enjoyed camping, driving up country to visit friends and relatives. If there's a definition of a family man, this is Carl Swift. I'm sure I've missed some of the stories. It was 97 years. Something about my dad that you know, something about my dad that you know that I did not touch on today. In honor of him and his storytelling, don't keep it to yourself. Share your stories with someone. Years from now, I'd love to hear his name, the name Carl Swift, and it won't be forgotten. Dad was honorable and loved by many. The last week and today has been a very hard time in our family. Speaking to friends and family yesterday, seeing all of you here today, our hearts are full. We are here to honor our father and our friend and to celebrate his great life. I said to a friend last week, I'll sum this up in my feelings for all of us, my family. I will miss my dad. Very much. We love you. We had a great time. You made a difference, and we will see you again. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. As Chris makes his way back up here, I invite the rest of you to please stand and face face the baptismal font area. I know many of you, but not all of you. My name is Father Phil Mulligan, and on behalf of myself and the entire faith community of Immaculate Heart of Mary, I want to take this moment at the beginning of our funeral mass to offer our deepest sympathies to the family and friends of Carl, in particular to the children Brenda, Carol Ann, Beth, Fred, Chris, to the 6 grandchildren, the 5 great-grandchildren, all the in-laws, including brother-in-law Lindsay, to his fellow Knights of Columbus, and all the good friends who are missing him at this point. Funerals, even for somebody who lived a good long life lived well, as Carl did, funerals are still hard times and hard places to be at. And yet, what we want to do today, in the middle of our sorrow and our leave-taking, is to offer Carl up to God in thanksgiving. And that's what Eucharist means. It's the old Greek word that means to give thanks. And so we do that today in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, risen for our salvation, be with you all.
And with your spirit.
On the day of his baptism, Carl was welcomed into the church, given new life in Christ, and clothed with the garment of salvation. Today we greet the body of our brother and surround him with the church's prayer. We surrender our brother Carl to the mercy of God and pray that the promise made him in baptism will be fulfilled. And so when Carl was baptized, I assume as an infant, he would have been sprinkled with holy water to remind those people then, as we are reminded now, that Carl was, is, and forever will be God's beloved son. Let us go forward now in song, giving thanks to God for Carl's life.
Our hymn is found in your parish hymnal. That's the blue book, page 58.
Shine like the sun and hold you in the
God of endless ages, from one generation to the next, you have been our refuge and strength. Before the mountains were born or the earth came to be, you are God. Have mercy now on your servant Carl, whose long life was spent in your service. Give him a place in your kingdom where hope is firm for all who love and rest is sure for all who serve. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Let's be seated now as we listen to the Word of God.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. Chapter 3, verses 1 through 8 and 11. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to pluck up wheat is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to saw, a time to keep silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war, a time for peace. God has made everything suitable for its time. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
pastures, where he gives me repose. Near as waters he leads me to revive my drooping spirit.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
He guides me along the right path, he is true to his name. If I should walk in the valley of darkness, no evil would I fear. With your crook and your staff, with these you give me comfort.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
You have prepared a banquet for me in the sight of my foes. My head you have anointed with oil, my cup is overflowing.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
Surely goodness and kindness shall follow me all the days of my life. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed. We might no longer be enslaved to sin, for whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Have eternal life.
The Lord be with you. A proclamation from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there and the two criminals also, one on his right and one on his left. One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding Jesus, saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you were under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus replied, "Truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Among Carl's many accomplishments, and remember, an obituary is only the tiniest of slices of a person's life and their accomplishments, I will remember Carl as a man of faith. I really only got to know him once he moved to People's Park Tower, one of the places where he lived his faith and is still missed by many. Carl belonged to perhaps the most unique generation ever to live. At 96 and almost 97, I don't think there was much that Carl didn't experience in one form or another. He belonged to the generation that had to make the biggest changes of any generation in the history of the world. He went from no phones to eventually party lines to smartphones that not only connect you instantly to someone on the other side of the world, but also gives you immediate information about any topic imaginable. Carl went from outhouses, horse and buggy, food derived from your own garden, wood stoves and one-room schoolhouses, clear through to space shuttles, and a world of science and technology that appears to be straight out of a Jules Verne novel. No generation outside of Carl's generation has had to deal with so much change. Carl had to say yes to so much, and I don't think he could have done it without being a man of faith, which he was. That is the best definition of faith I've come across. Faith is the ability to say yes to what is right in front of me. Even if the situation in front of me is something I don't like, I don't agree with, I don't understand, I wish I could change, or even something that seems unfair or unjust. Some people dig in their heels, resist all change, and resort as much as they can to the simpler good old days, a magical world that no longer exists, but that brings them comfort. Carl said yes to the whole mystery that life is. The ultimate mystery is the mystery of God. That is how we are held with such love, compassion, and mercy by God, even and especially when we are not always loving, compassionate, and merciful to each other. In theological terms, the church calls this the Paschal Mystery. The Paschal Mystery is essentially the movement that brings life out of death. With all our science and technology, with all our wishes and prayers, we cannot bring life out of death. Once something or someone is dead, we cannot reverse it. We grieve what we lose, and we move on as best we can.
This is not the way it is with God. God delights and is in the business of transforming death into new life, not just an extension of the old life. Our job, and I think Carl did this so well, is to say yes to the entire Paschal mystery, the dying and the rising of all things. Jesus died and rose to new life. His life is the pattern of all our lives. There is no renewal in all of nature without something first dying. Humans seem to be the only ones who want to resist this. Carl didn't fight it. With his faith, he said yes to both ends of the stick, to all that life offered him, both good and bad. Carl said yes to a time to be born and a time to die. He said yes to a time to break down and a time to build up. He said yes to a time to tear and to a time to sow. He said yes to a time for war and yes to a time for peace. Was it easy for him? And is it easy for us? No. Nor was it easy for Jesus. That's why faith is so important. There is someone in the gospel who resists the Paschal mystery, someone unlike Carl, who feels he should be exempt from dying and just leapfrog into resurrection. He is one of the criminals who was crucified next to Jesus. He says to Jesus, "If you are the Messiah, save yourself and save us." He wants resurrection, but he doesn't think we have to die first. He's not willing to say yes to the entire Paschal mystery, which includes both dying and rising. Jesus is willing to enter into the pattern of dying and rising and will not take privilege for himself just because he is God's son. Carl also did not take privilege for himself. He did not skip the line nor try to do an end run around death. Carl knew what St. Paul knew, that we were buried with Christ by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of God, so we too might walk in newness of life. Isn't it interesting that the Gospels both begin and end with someone saying yes to what is right in front of them? The Gospels begin with Mary saying yes to being the mother of the Messiah when she responds to God through the angel Gabriel, "Let it be done to me according to your word." In other words, I'm all in, even though I don't fully know where my yes will take me. I can say yes because I know you will accompany me through any struggle, any pain, and even death itself until we both walk together into the light of the resurrection. And then the Gospels end with Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane praying, "I say yes, not to my will, Father, but to your will." Like Mary, Jesus is saying, "Let your life-giving will be done in me and through me." In other words, life isn't about me, but I am about life. I think Carl would have said that over and over again, maybe not in so many words. Life isn't about me, but I am about life. As we get older, life circumstances forces us to say yes to many things, like failing health and having to let go of so much that in our earlier years we clearly would have said no to. With Jesus as our ultimate model and Carl's example, hopefully we can say yes to all the little deaths we encounter each day. When we do that, we will also be saying yes to all the little resurrections that are also part of life. the little deaths and resurrections lived well bring us ultimately to Christ, who will say to us, as he says to Carl, "Truly today, you will be with me in paradise." My brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we now join our prayers to his.
For Carol, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, may he now be admitted to the company of the saints. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In this life, Carol shared many times around the Lord's table. May he now take his place at the heavenly banquet reserved for him. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our loved ones who have gone before us in death, may they experience peace, rest, and joy in the company of Jesus and all the saints. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who are missing Carol at this time, may they be filled with the Lord's peace and healing. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us called here today to worship in faith, may we be gathered together again in God's kingdom. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our unspoken intentions. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. O God, creator and redeemer of all the faithful, grant to the souls of your departed servants release from their sins. Hear our prayers for those we love and give them the pardon they have always desired through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Our hymn is found in the Catholic Book of Worship. That's the green book. Page 481. You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand. You shall see faith of God and live. If you pass through raging waters in the sea, you shall not drown. If you walk amid the burning flames, you shall not be harmed. If you stand before the power of hell, and death is at your side, know that I am with you through it all. Be not afraid.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Father Almighty. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Carl, we seek your mercy, that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. The fount of all holiness, make holy, therefore, these gifts by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the cup, and once more giving thanks, he handed the cup to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Valerie, our bishop, Francis, our pope, all the clergy, and all your holy people. Remember your servant Carl, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also all our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Uniting our voices, we pray that one and only prayer that Jesus ever taught us, the one Carl would have prayed thousands of times in his lifetime. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. And may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Grant us peace.
This is Jesus the Lord, the resurrection and the life. Happy are we who are invited to share in his supper. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. If you are coming forward for communion, I invite you to come up by way of the center aisle and go back by way of the side aisles, okay?
Our hymn is in your parish hymnal, page 61. That's the blue book. One bread, one body, one cup, one call, one faith, one spirit, present in us all. One prayer, one blessing, one hope, one peace, one church, one
let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our brother Carl may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. As a sign of respect for our brother, Carl, we let this incense rise to God, who has called him to share in his glory.
Our hymn is in the Catholic Book of Worship, page 10C.
Surrender the soul of Carl, your servant. In the sight of this world, he is now dead. In your sight, may he live forever. Forgive whatever sins he committed through human weakness, and in your goodness, grant him everlasting peace through Christ our Lord. Dear friends, may every mark of affection and every gesture of friendship that you give to others be a sign of God's peace for you. In peace and in the sure hope of the resurrection, we take leave of our brother, knowing that one day we shall be with him in heaven. The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless Carl and all of you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our celebration is ended. We go in peace.
Thanks be to God. Our hymn is in your parish hymnal, page 82.
We shall go out with hope of resurrection. We shall go out from strength to strength, go on. We shall go out and tell our
your stories boldly, tales of a love that will not let us go. We'll sing our songs to the wrongs that can be righted. We'll dream our dreams of hurts that can be healed. We'll leave a glove of all the world united with the vision of you. Give a voice to those who have not spoken. We'll find the words for those whose lips are sealed. We'll make the tunes for those who sing no longer. Express of love.